HarperCollins and Harper Audio present Don't Turn Out the Lights, a tribute to Alvin Schwartz's Scary Stories to Tell in the Dark, edited by Jonathan Maberry, performed by Adam Verner and Hilary Huber. Editor's Foreword. Reflections of an overgrown kid camping in the woods at night. When I was a kid, there were scary stories, but not scary stories to tell in the dark. Those books were published in the 80s, when I was already in my early 20s. By then, I was big and tough and worked as a bodyguard. I wasn't afraid of much, not anymore, but I remember being afraid. I remember liking how that felt. The ripples of goosebumps along my arms when there was a sound in the dark I couldn't identify. The sudden intake of breath when something fell over in my closet for no good reason. The jolt to my heart as a floorboard creaked when I knew for sure no one else was home. I lived in an old row home, so sure, the place groaned and moaned, and the rational part of my mind knew that there were logical explanations. Foundation settling, the wood frame sagging under the weight of years, a mouse behind the wall. There were always explanations, but that didn't stop me from being afraid. Yeah, I really liked being afraid. I wanted scary stories, even when I wasn't allowed. I read horror comics, and I spent a lot of time listening to my grandmother, we called her Nanny, tell spooky stories. She knew a lot of them. She was pretty spooky herself. Born on Halloween, and I think about a million years old, or at least she seemed that old. Her face was all wrinkles and creases, but her eyes were young, like a fairy or an imp, pretending to be an elderly lady. Her house was filled with books about vampires, werewolves, ghosts, and all kinds of things that went bump in the dark. If Luna Lovegood from the Harry Potter novels was someone's grandmother, that would be Nanny. I loved her. She was my favorite person. She told me strange tales about haunted houses and monsters in closets and headless horsemen and crawly things that didn't have a name. She told me about lost souls and hungry ghouls and disembodied hands scuttling like spiders. I used to think that she made those stories up, but later on discovered that she only made some of them up. A lot of those tales were old, older than her in some cases. Tales that were handed down over the years like creepy heirlooms. Campfire stories, urban legends, myths, and even versions of classic fiction. I first met Dracula in one of her stories, but the way she told it was different from the novel I later read. The same with The Strange Case of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, Frankenstein, and The Phantom of the Opera. She reshaped these tales to fit her mood and her likes and her quirky sense of humor. And that was absolutely perfect. I've since retold some of her tales to my sister's kids. Yes, I was the weird uncle who told spooky stories to my nephews. Proud of that, too. I first encountered Alvin Schwartz's Scary Stories to Tell in the Dark in 1983. I was about to go camping alone and wanted something creepy to read. The salesman at the bookstore said that the book was filled with campfire stories and weird stuff like that. He warned me that it was mostly for elementary readers, but I didn't care. I bought it, and the latest books by Stephen King and Robert McCammon. I spent a week camping and canoeing in the Pine Barrens of New Jersey. It is a vast forest, and you can be completely alone and cut off from everyone in a 5-minute walk from the banks of the stream. I paddled along the cedar water streams and hiked the woods, and then spent some very pleasant hours scaring the absolute bejesus out of myself reading those stories. King scared me because Stephen King scares everyone. McCammon scared me because he knows exactly how to do that. But when I opened Schwartz's book, I expected to be amused but not actually scared. After all, I was a big, tough adult with black belts. And yet... there is something especially fascinating about spooky stories intended for young readers. There is a simplicity to them that is deceptive. like an apple offered by a kindly old lady. Ask Snow White how that turned out. Sure, the setting had a lot to do with it. All by myself in a night-dark forest, with 10,000 insects and animals out there watching me. This was years before cell phones were a thing. When you get lost in a forest like that, you are truly lost. You gain a whole new understanding of the word alone. Alvin Schwartz's stories genuinely creeped me out. Some of them I even recognized as urban legends or folklore, but he gave them unnerving little twists. They were campfire tales, and I was huddled, with no one else around, by a campfire. Sounds absurd, sure. Tough guy like me being spooked by stories for kids. But don't forget, the kid we used to be is still alive in all of us. And the civilized part of us is only one power failure, one bad storm, one unexplainable moment of strangeness away from being a primitive and terrified caveman. When I got back from my trip, and no, I was not attacked by pop-eyed goblins, giant spiders, or the ghost of a serial killer, I went looking for more of those books. Unfortunately, I had to wait until Halloween of the following year to get more scary stories to tell in the dark. And then there was a gap of years before Scary Stories 3, More Tales to Chill Your Bones, was published. And after that, nothing. No more. Alvin Schwartz died the year after that third book was published. He was in his mid-60s, not much older than I am now. I left bodyguard work behind and became a college instructor, teaching martial arts history, women's self-defense, and jujitsu. Then I ran a dojo, and soon I became a graphic artist. All of that was on the way to deciding to try my hand at writing my own scary stories. My first horror novel, Ghost Road Blues, was published in 2006. And I've written dozens of novels, short stories, and creepy comic books since then. Over the years, I've lost count of how many copies of the complete set of scary stories I've bought for friends. Not just for the kids of friends, but for any of my friends who like a creepy story well told. All of those copies could probably fill a truck. No, better yet, they could build a pretty cool fort to hide in on dark and stormy nights. When the Horror Writers Association and HarperCollins teamed up to do a tribute anthology, I was very excited. When they asked me to edit it, I was floored. I even got a little misty. Kind of wish Nanny was still with us. She'd be delighted. I began reaching out to writers to see who might be interested. I was hoping that a few of the better authors I knew had heard of Alvin Schwartz's books, or maybe had bought them for their own children. What I did not expect was that all of them knew and loved these stories. Everyone had a favorite, and some could recite them from memory. When I talk to booksellers and librarians about this new book, I see their eyes light up. Even today, all these years later, the Scary Stories books fly off the shelves. Every time I visit a library, I check to see if there are copies, and I find new and old editions that have been read so many times they are falling to pieces. This volume contains 35 original stories. Most of them are short, like Schwartz's tales, and a few are longer, introducing younger readers to the standard short story form, but in a pretty creepy way. All of them are delightful and spooky and downright weird. I know that the new generation of readers will enjoy them and hopefully be skeeved out. And I am so happy to be able to share these new stories with the millions who either grew up with the original scary stories or folks like me who discovered them later and read them to the children in their lives. So, if you're not camping in the deep, dark woods, then wait until night has fallen. Pull a sheet over your head and read by flashlight. Let's all be kids again with these scary stories, inspired by the scary stories that started it all. Jonathan Maberry, editor.
The Funeral Portrait by Laurent Lynn. Terror was about to infect the kingdom, and panic spread like a virus. Queen Benevola balanced on the edge of death, and her only child, Malvino Mondamas, was next in line. He would become king. As intensely as the kind queen was beloved, her demoniac son, Mondamas, was despised. But the royal family wielded the power. Nothing could be done. Or so everyone believed. Señora Alma's acclaimed lineage reached as far back as the royal families. She and her ancestors performed one solemn duty, painting the royal funeral portraits. And so, on her deathbed, knowing her long life was at its end, Queen Benevola summoned the revered portrait artist to fulfill her task. Supported by a simple wooden cane and wrapped in a black shawl, the reclusive painter dutifully arrived at the palace to create the painting. Tales of old, wrinkled Señora Alma and her accomplished legacy spanned generations. Some said she was 100 years old, maybe even two. No matter her true age, she was distinctly skilled and painted the queen's funeral portrait with unparalleled speed. For just as Señora Alma applied her last dab of pigment to the canvas, the queen exhaled her last breath. "How fortunate," Señora Alma said. "I was able to paint her while she was still alive." Queen Benevola's remains rested in the Galleria, a long hall with carved paneling and trembling candlelight. Most striking were the life-size oil paintings, centuries of royal funeral portraits that lined the walls of the gallery like a timeline of compassion, occasionally punctured by tyranny, all with penetrating painted eyes. At the end was the funeral portrait of the queen's father, King Tirano, a despot who had ruled with vicious cruelty. His seething glare was chilling, even if only caught on canvas. But next to that, above her casket, now hung Queen Benevola's glorious funeral portrait, an uncanny likeness. While the folds of her turquoise gown had the illusion of being true velvet, and the rubies of her crown looked like they reflected actual flame, the rendering of the queen herself stole one's breath. It was as if pulsing blood flowed through the applied pigments of her skin, and a vivid spirit shone through her painted gaze. When Señora Alma arrived in the Galleria to pay her last respects, the gathered nobility and commoners showered the legendary painter with praise. "You are too kind," Señora Alma admired her masterpiece. "I simply attempt to replicate in paint what I glean from the person's soul." A noble woman scowled up at the portrait of King Tirano. "You certainly gleaned what was in him," she shuddered. "It's as if the painting stares through me." Señora Alma frowned at the portrayal of the previous king that she had painted so many years before. "I captured him all too well, didn't I?" A commanding voice boomed through the Galleria. "Where's that woman?" Everyone turned. It was the newly crowned King Malvino Mandamas himself. Strutting beside him was his 11-year-old son, Prince Consentido, who had the eyes of his grandmother, but the bearing of his father.
"Señora Alma," the new King Mandamas barked, "the way you've painted my mother is impressive."
He put his hands on his hips.
"You will paint my portrait."
The crowd gasped. Everyone knew the old proverb. It was perilous to have one's funeral portrait painted when one was in their prime. Prince Consentido interrupted.
"What about me? I want a portrait too."
"Quiet,"
Mandamas shoved his son away.
"I'm the king." "But King Mandamas,"
a groveling court minister said.
"What about the fate of your grandfather, King Tirano? He had Señora Alma paint his portrait when he was young, and look what happened. It brought the curse."
A slight grin started to light on Señora Alma's face, but she quickly extinguished it and resumed her somber expression.
"You think I believe that stupidity?"
King Mandamas said.
"When my likeness hangs in this hall someday, it shall resemble me now, when I'm young and handsome, not when I'm old and sickly."
He waved his hand up at Queen Benevola's portrait. Señora Alma bowed as low as her elderly bones would allow.
"Sire, I cannot break from my family's tradition, and will paint your funeral portrait only once. To capture you in your full glory, I must first observe what kind of ruler you will be.
King Mondamas huffed, then glanced up at his mother's portrait. Her painted amber eyes sparked, no doubt merely a reflection of flickering candlelight.
I'll be the greatest ruler, you'll see. Return in a year's time, and be prepared.
He spun on his heel and left with Prince.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.